In the 6th century BC, the king of Judah was defeated by Nebuchadnezzar. Now, besides carrying off items from the temple in Jerusalem to be added to Nebuchadnezzar's treasury, a select group of young men were also taken to Babylon to serve in Nebuchadnezzar's government. Daniel was one of these young men. The first 6 chapters of the Old Testament book of Daniel contain some of the best-known Bible stories, including the story of Daniel in the lion's den, the handwriting on the wall, the one about the 3 who survived Nebuchadnezzar's fiery furnace, and also the story about the time when Nebuchadnezzar told his astrologers to interpret one of his dreams. But he refused to tell them what his dream had been about. You see, Nebuchadnezzar was beginning to doubt whether his magicians, sorcerers, astrologers were really interpreting his dreams or just making stuff up and telling him whatever they thought he wanted to hear. So Nebuchadnezzar tested them. If you don't tell me what my dream was and interpret it, I'll have you cut into pieces. Well, the astrologers responded, and we read their response in Daniel chapter 2, verse 10. There is not a person on earth who can do what the king asks. No king, however great and mighty, has ever asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or astrologer. What the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods, and they do not live among human beings. Well, this angered Nebuchadnezzar so much that he commanded that all the wise men of the kingdom be killed. Now, this mass execution would have also included Daniel and his friends. So when Daniel heard the news, he immediately went to the king and he asked for time so that he might interpret the dream for the king. And then he went back to his friends and he urged them, and we're reading from Daniel chapter 2, verse 18, plead for mercy from God of heaven concerning this mystery. Well, that night, Nebuchadnezzar's dream was revealed by God to Daniel in a vision. As Daniel explained to Nebuchadnezzar, reading from Daniel chapter 2, verse 28, there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in days to come. Reading from the Septuagint, or the Greek version of the Old Testament prophets, the verb which means to reveal is translated into Greek from Hebrew as apokalypto. An apocalypse is an uncovering, a revealing of something otherwise unknown. Besides the visible, natural world which we can see all around us, there is another invisible, supernatural world. And these two realms, the natural and the supernatural, are inseparably intertwined. See, both the Old Testament book of Daniel and the New Testament book of Revelation, both are apocalyptic in that they open our eyes to a reality beyond that which we can see for ourselves. When we get to the 7th chapter of the book of Daniel, we realize that we've turned a corner. Gone are the stories. No longer is Daniel cast in the role of interpreting Nebuchadnezzar's dreams and visions. Instead, Daniel has now become the dreamer. Reading from the book of Daniel, chapter 7. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream, and visions passed through his mind as he was lying in bed. He wrote down the substance of his dream. Daniel said, "In my vision at night I looked, and there before me were the 4 winds of heaven, churning up the great sea. 4 great beasts, each different from the others, came up out of the sea. The first was like a lion, and it had the wings of an eagle. I watched until its wings were torn off and it was lifted from the ground so that it stood on 2 feet like a human being, and the mind of a human was given to it. And there before me was a second beast, which looked like a bear. It was raised up on one of its sides, and it had 3 ribs in its mouth between its teeth. It was told, "Get up, eat your fill of flesh." After that I looked, and there before me was another beast, one that looked like a leopard, and on its back it had 4 wings like those of a bird. The beast had 4 heads, and it was given authority to rule. After that, in my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was a 4th beast, terrifying and frightening and very powerful. It had large iron teeth. It crushed and devoured its victims and trampled underfoot whatever was left. It was different from all the former beasts, and it had 10 horns. While I was thinking about the horns, there before me was another horn, a little one, which came up among them, and 3 of the 1st horns were uprooted before it. This horn had eyes like the eyes of a human being and a mouth that spoke boastfully. Several verses later, it's revealed that these 4 beasts represent 4 successive empires to come. And these 4 kingdoms have since been identified in history as, first, the Babylonians from 6th century BC, represented by the lion with wings like an eagle. Second, from mid-5th century BC, the Medes and the Persians, represented by the bear with 3 ribs in its mouth. Third, the Greeks under Alexander the Great from mid-3rd century BC, represented by the leopard with 4 wings and 4 heads. But it was the 4th beast that really captured Daniel's attention and prompted his question to the angel about what it all means. The angel replies with this explanation. The 4th beast is a 4th kingdom. That will appear on earth. It will be different from all the other kingdoms, will devour the whole earth, trampling it down and crushing it. The 10 horns are 10 kings who will come from this kingdom, and after them another king will arise different from the earlier ones. He will subdue 3 kings. He will speak against the Most High and oppress his holy people and try to change the set times and the laws. The holy people will be delivered into his hands for a time, times, and half a time. But the court will sit, and his power will be taken away and completely destroyed forever. Then the sovereignty, power, and greatness of all the kingdoms under heaven will be handed over to the holy people of the Most High. His kingdom will be an everlasting kingdom, and all rulers will worship and obey him. The description given in Daniel chapter 11 of this 4th beast is said to refer to Antiochus the 4th Epiphanes, a Macedonian Hellenistic king who reigned from 175 to 164 BC. Antiochus initiated a violent persecution of the Jews. He tried to destroy both their temple and their way of life. Looking back at history, we can see that Daniel's visions did accurately predict events to come in the centuries leading up to Jesus' birth. History confirms that there is indeed more to Daniel's visions than just a very vivid imagination. But the question to ask is, do they also have something to say about events to come in our future? Daniel's visions became the canvas on which centuries later another servant of God named John would record down in as vivid imagery as Daniel's his own apocalyptic visions. John's apocalyptic vision is contained in the New Testament book of Revelation, or the last book in the Bible. The book of Revelation opens with the following verses. The revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw, that is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. You see, there are striking similarities between Daniel's apocalyptic vision and John's. And the parallel becomes most evident in Revelation chapter 13, where what we see is the combination of the features of the four beasts from Daniel 7 into one. Reading from Revelation chapter 13, verse 1, the dragon stood on the shore of the sea, and I saw a beast coming out of the sea. It had 10 horns and 7 heads, with 10 crowns on its horns, and each head a blasphemous name. The beast I saw resembled a leopard, but had feet like those of a bear, and a mouth like that of a lion. The dragon gave the beast his power and his throne and great authority. Now those to whom John was writing, they lived toward the end of the first century. This would have been around 96 AD, and they would have recognized the beast as the superpower of their own day, Rome. The first century church, those reading John's revelation, his apocalypse, reading it for the first time, they were experiencing firsthand the actions of a human authority behaving as a demonic beast. And no different from the worst of the ancient enemies of God's people, including Antiochus Epiphanes. Many of those to whom John was writing, these early Christians, they were suffering terribly. The Roman Emperor Domitian had filled Rome with statues of himself. Those who refused to address him as our Lord and God and offer sacrifices to his image, they faced a horrible death. Some were impaled on stakes, covered in pitch, and burned alive to serve as torches. Some were torn to pieces by the lions in the arena. Christians were crucified by the thousands. To these early Christians, John wrote the following. I'm reading from Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. John had a vision of the future. The old order passed away, the end of suffering, the defeat of evil, heaven come down, transforming the earth, everything made new. But then, evil still exists. What was true in Daniel's day, what was true for the first century believers in John's day, remains true today. As Christ's disciples, both then, first century, and now, 21st century, we still live under the beast's rule, which can only be described as evil, demonic. Both Daniel's apocalyptic vision and John's revelation describe the forces of evil at work down through the ages. But at the same time, they affirm the good news of the ultimate defeat of evil at the hand of an all-powerful righteous God. Reading from Daniel chapter 7, continuing from verse 9, as I looked, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was as white as snow. The hair of his head was white like wool. His throne was flaming with fire, and its wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated. The books were opened. Then I continued to watch because of the boastful words that the horn was speaking. I kept looking until the beast was slain and its body destroyed and thrown into the blazing fire. The other beasts had been stripped of their authority, but were allowed to live for a period of time. In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. Daniel describes one like a son of man who approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. There are repeated references throughout the Gospels where Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man. Matthew records Jesus saying, "Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." From Mark's Gospel, Jesus speaking, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." From what Jesus said at his trial before the high priest, Jesus clearly saw himself as the one about whom Daniel spoke. Those hearing Jesus obviously made that same connection. Reading from Mark chapter 14, the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" "I am," said Jesus, "and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." After hearing that, the high priest and all those around Jesus were enraged and demanded Jesus be condemned for blasphemy and be put to death. Earlier on, before Jesus' arrest, while speaking with his disciples, Jesus had prophesied about his return in glory, telling them, reading from Matthew chapter 24, verse 30, "Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then all the peoples of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other." In his first letter to the Thessalonians, which is likely one of the earliest writings contained in the New Testament, Paul encourages those to whom he is writing with what Jesus is quoted as saying in Matthew 24. Reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 15, "According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with a trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words." Jesus is the Son of Man in Daniel's vision. Jesus is the Lamb of God in John's revelation. Remember how John the Baptist, on seeing Jesus approach, called out, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Jesus is the Lamb of God who also appears in John's vision, recorded in Revelation chapter 5. The Lamb, appearing as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, receives the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. Those around the throne are singing a new song. "You are worthy to take the scroll, to open its seals, because you were slain. And with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever." Jesus is the Lamb of God who gave his life not only to win our salvation but also to defeat evil. We look forward to Jesus' return and the coming of the kingdom of God. There can be no better vision for us as individuals and a community of believers than this vision of our Lord God and Savior, Jesus Christ, coming in glory and power. When people from every nation and language will bow down and worship him and give him total allegiance and obedience. We echo John's concluding words in Revelation chapter 22, "Come, Lord Jesus." This is our great hope, that one day, in fact, there will be no more evil, no more sickness, no more pain. Unlike Daniel's apocalypse, John's first vision recorded in the first chapter of Revelation was not of horrible beasts, but instead the person of the crucified and risen Christ. Revelation chapter 1, verse 12, "I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, 'Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead and now look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write therefore what you have seen, what is now and what will take place later.'" We who have put our trust in Jesus have this blessed hope that we shall see our Savior face to face. For now, as Paul wrote to the Corinthians, for now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. "Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known." Until that day comes, no matter the evil we face in this world, we must hold fast to the hope of our Savior's glorious return in power and glory.
Oh, I'm a traveler, far from home. I get lost, but I press on. 'Cause there's a mansion and streets of gold where I belong. Yes, there's a day coming soon where the old will be made new, and heaven's glory shines like the morning before our eyes. No more madness. see Jesus face to face. And then we will sing with angel voices. There will be a great rejoicing. Holy, holy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb. Oh, 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 oh. We
Remember how in the Garden of Eden, before the fall, God would walk in the cool of the day. God and man enjoyed each other's company. In the beginning, there was true fellowship between God and man. Even after man's sin broke that relationship with God, God never stopped loving us. He never gave up on us. God sent his son Jesus to take the judgment for our sin on himself on the cross. You see, Jesus came to make all things new. He carried that cross and with it all our guilt and shame, and he did it to make all things new.
Help me.
He will make all things new. You see, God's ultimate plan is to come and live with us in the realm which he has made for us. The dwelling of God will be with men. He will live with us. This glorious new heaven and this new earth is coming. Eden will be Eden again. Reading from Revelation chapter 21, "Then I saw a new heaven and new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Behold, I make all things new. When this glorious day comes, and there is a new heaven and a new earth, what will we remember about our lives here and now? Will we remember the suffering, pain? C.S. Lewis writes this. He said, They say of some temporal suffering, no future bliss can make up for it. Not knowing heaven, once attained, will work backwards and turn even that agony into glory. You see, our happiness in heaven is not based on ignorance or forgetfulness, but perspective. We will have that heavenly perspective on life. The early Christians lived in a terribly cruel environment, but still their hope could not be crushed. They took what John said literally. It was their hope, and it must be our hope too. None of us will likely be thrown to lions or crucified, but still, there are circumstances in our lives that threaten our well-being. This promise of a new order, that he will make all things new, gives us hope and enables us to triumph over whatever we are going through here and now. What is troubling you? Is it sickness? Are you grieving the loss of a loved one? Are you suffering from feelings of betrayal by a friend, a colleague, a family member? Are you tormented by doubt and worry? Whatever it is, all this evil will pass away. This is our hope. No more death. No more sickness. No more pain. No more suffering. This is our hope.
One day there'll be no more waiting left for our souls. One day there'll be no more children longing for home. One day when the kingdom comes right here where we stand, we will see the promised land. One day there'll be no more lives taken too soon. One day there'll be no more need for a hospital room. One day every tear that falls will be wiped by his hand, and we will see the promised land. Every tongue will confess. One day when I'm tired and weary, both find the rest. One day when the power of evil's brought to an end, we will see the promised land. We will see the promised land. Hallelujah. We'll be healed from this heartbreak we've been feeling. We're singing in the darkest night, cause we know now the light will come and there will be healing. Hallelujah. There will be healing. Hallelujah. And there will be healing. Hallelujah.
Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for the promise, the hope that we have to look forward to. Thank you for what Jesus did for us, not only giving us salvation through his death on the cross, but also defeating evil, making all things new. Our Heavenly Father, I pray that you would give us that sure hope in our hearts, that until that day comes, as we experience sickness, suffering, grief, that will not overwhelm us, that will not defeat us, but that we will be strong in the hope of your sure promise that one day we will be with you in that new heaven and that new earth. And we will know your love, your power. We will see Jesus face to face. We look forward to that day. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.